Hello everyone, this is Jeremy Mulfay with Fundamental Tennis. If you enjoy this video, please give me a like, subscribe to the channel, and click that notification bell if you haven't already so you can see my weekly videos that come out every Sunday. Now today's video is part two to last week's part one video in which we talked about the number one technical fundamental to your ground stroke. Whether you have a forehand or a two or one-handed backhand, you are going to see the number one or most important technical aspect to the ground strokes. If you want to see that video, again, last week's video, all you have to do is scroll down to the description below and click the link. Today's video, again, is part two, in which we're going to talk about the second biggest fundamental to the technique on your ground stroke. So what is the two most important parts of your ground stroke technique? Last week was part one. Today is the second most important fundamental, and you're going to find that this fundamental is going to help you with the five ball controls, or the five different things you can do with the ball. And that is, you can improve your speed, spin, depth, direction, or height of the ball you're sending with your ground stroke. So stay tuned, enjoy the video, let's do it. First, we're going to talk about the forehand and the two-handed backhand, and then towards the end of the video, you'll hear something a little different in terms of the technique to the one-handed backhand. So the second big checkpoint that I always look for when it comes to ground stroke technique is the extension of the hitting arm and hand outwards and upwards after the contact. It's very common that players make contact and then immediately swing across their body and to the follow-through. What you want to do is, after contact, bring the hitting hand out towards your target as well as up prior to following through behind your back or to the shoulder or wherever you want to finish. So we do not want to go from contact straight to the follow-through. The follow-through is emphasized so much, and it can be a good reference point as giving you information to how well the prior parts of your stroke was. However, if you focus just on the follow-through without much thought on the extension, then you are going to go from contact to the follow-through, which is a big issue. So we want to go from contact out and up with extension of the arm, and then with this extension you will naturally follow through correctly. So a good checkpoint is the hand of your racket arm should go to about head level, and you should have as much spacing as possible between your hand and your body when you are at the farthest extension point after contact. Now, of course, when you're trying to hit an angle or a topspin lob, or you're trying to hit it to the net player's feet, the extension will be very different. So I'm talking about the traditional ground stroke in which you're trying to get the ball deep to the opponent's side near the baseline. So that extension of the hand and arm is huge. So I'd like you to use all this slow-mo footage of my strokes and notice how after I hit the ball, I don't follow through immediately. I go out and up with my hand. You can see my arm is extended at contact. My arm is pretty much straight at and after contact. It's not necessary to have the arm totally straight at and after contact. In fact, that makes it a bit more challenging for most players. If you're not a very advanced player, that can be quite difficult. However, again, we'd like to have that arm as close to as straight as possible at contact and after contact. Think about some of the best forehands in the world right now, some of the best players ever. Federer, Nadal, they have the best extension that I have ever seen. Del Potro's another one's got one of the biggest forehands in terms of miles per hour on average. Now, it's widely believed that the contact point is one of the most important parts of every stroke, and I certainly agree with that. Now, when we say that the most important part of the stroke is arguably the contact phase, well, if you don't extend after contact, then that shows your contact was poor. I'm not sure I've ever had someone improve their contact by telling them to hit the ball in front. However, when I get them to extend, or we focus on the extension of the arm out and up after contact, they would naturally hit the ball in front without them even thinking about hitting the ball in front. So I have found that the extension, or focusing on the extension of the hitting arm out to the target, naturally improves the contact point, gets players to rotate their hips, gets them to hit the ball in front of their body. We've all been told to hit in front of the body, and this is just a natural way to hit the ball in front of the body. Again, I've never had a player hit the ball in front by me saying hit the ball in front. So this extension is a great reference point to see if you did in fact have quality contact. And just in general, if you have good extension after contact, this shows that you did everything well before that point. Specifically, again, that contact phase was a quality contact. If you have good extension, if you did not have good extension, then something definitely went wrong, whether it was your positioning or your contact was late or your preparation was late. So again, I love to look at the extension or lack thereof after the contact point to tell me if the player did everything well prior to that point. And a lot of you are probably thinking, well, what does it matter what I do after contact? Why do I need to focus on extension after contact when the ball is already long gone? Well, I would say if you do not extend the hitting arm and hand after contact, then it means that you are already going across your body with your swing path too early prior to the contact. So again, I love to use the watching players' extension, focusing on the extension to tell me how everything was prior to contact. Once again, if there's not extension after contact, then something went wrong during that contact phase. And we all know that every stroke is all about when the ball hits the strings. I mentioned in the beginning of the video about how extension helps the five ball controls. Now let's start with the spin. We all know that low to high swing path creates that spin, that topspin we want, the spin where the ball is moving forward end over end like a bicycle tire spinning from 6 to 12 o'clock if we use the ball as a clock reference. Now, when you are getting that extension out and up, that is simply the high part of low to high. So that is how it's going to create these top spin for you. Now, when it comes to the speed, when you extend out to the target, you're of course going to get more racket head speed, therefore more ball speed, as opposed to if you are not extending out to the target and you're swinging more laterally across the baseline. So that is the spin and the speed. And when it comes to depth, if you bring your arms out and up, the ball will go out and up more so, not out past the baseline, but out and landing near the baseline. Because the arms are going out, the ball will have that extension, more length, because you're swinging your arms out with more length. Now when it comes to direction, this extension allows you to keep the strings to the target during that contact phase and after the contact, which will make it easier to direct the ball because the strings, again, stay to the target longer. It just makes timing easier. Now, when it comes to the height of the ball, obviously, when you swing up, you get that extension out and up, the ball will have more height over the net versus if you have more of a level swing path. I have found that working on this extension helps players with their timing, because players know that they cannot get the extension if they don't hit the ball in front of their body. So when players focus on the extension, they naturally have much better timing, because they simply can't get to that part of the stroke, that being extension, of course, if they do not prepare early and hit the ball in front. Another great reason to work on extension is it's incredibly common that players consistently get too close to the ball at contact. Now, what the extension does in focusing on the extension is it allows you to naturally create space during your backswing or during your unit turn, and it allows you to naturally create space at contact because you know you have to finish with that extension or that spacing between your upper arm and your body after the hit. Looking back at last week's video, in which we talked about the very specific preparation timing you need, and when we add today's tip of extension, I have found that when you get the beginning of the stroke right, that being the preparation, and you get the end of the stroke right, that being extension, everything in between, including the all-important contact point, happens well and naturally. Instead of thinking about other factors that are not fundamental, like so many players do, just focus on these two fundamentals, starting with the preparation. Instead of focusing on five different things, just focus on preparation and extension, and oftentimes you'll fix all five things effortlessly and naturally with some disciplined practice. Also, I think it's a great idea to video yourself to see where you're at with the progress, and before you start working on this stuff, video yourself so you can have a bit of a before and after video. All right, now on to the one-handed backhand groundstroke. Now, this is a little bit different technical cue than the two-handed backhand and the forehand. Many of you have heard that you want to stay sideways during the one-handed backhand, stay sideways longer, much more so than the two-handed backhand, especially the forehand. But how do we stay sideways? Some of you may know this as well. You want to use your non-dominant arm to go back and down during the forward swing. That is how you stay sideways. Now, why do we want to stay sideways? That is not discussed much at all. In fact, I'm not sure I've ever heard anybody say why you want to stay sideways. There's a few reasons, but one of them is staying sideways allows you to keep the swing path on a straighter line for a longer period of time. I'm talking about the forward swing. If you open up too early, more than likely due to not bringing the left arm back and down, then you are going to swing across your body too early, which is going to cause the ball to have side spin, which likely is going to make the ball sail long because you don't have that top spin. So again, staying sideways allows you to create that top spin by having the correct swing path. If I open up too early, I'm going to swing across my body too early. So that's kind of similar to what I talked about with the forehand and the two-handed backhand, in which we want to go out to the target with good extension. Imagine keeping on that straight line prior to going across the body for the finish. When swinging across your body too early, which again is a symptom of not staying sideways, you will have less control of the angle of the racket face, and the racket face will not stay to the target long enough. So it's harder to time that, as the strings don't point to your intended target for as long. Also, the pros step across their body much more often than not. I'm talking about a one-handed backhand, of course. And this is because this cross step makes it easier to stay sideways and lengthens the forward swing path. So the main factor is you must stay sideways to have a chance at having the right swing path, and then you will be able to create that topspin. Topspin's the only way to control the ball, besides, of course, just dinking the ball back. Topspin is the only way to get the ball in the court consistently when swinging fast. So staying sideways will give you a chance at creating that topspin. Now, this staying sideways, as I said, allows you to swing towards the target for a much longer period of time, which will give you more power. And when it comes to depth, getting the ball to land closer to the baseline than the service line, so you can push the opponent back and make sure that your opponent has a weak court position so they can't hurt you. This depth is created by this extension out to the target. A couple good key check points to make sure that you're staying sideways and you have the right swing path is to ensure that at the end of the swing, your left arm has gone back and down so that your chest is out and your shoulder blades are pinching together. Now, another good checkpoint is also you want your hitting hand to be at about the height of the middle of your head when you finish the swing. Lastly, your hips should be approximately at a 45 degree angle in comparison to the baseline when you are done with your swing. So guys, I don't want you to just watch and listen to the video. I'd love for you to go out and apply these tips and let me know how it goes in the comments section below. I'd love to hear your thoughts, opinions, and questions. So just feel free to reach out to me. Once again, give me a like, subscribe to the channel, and hit that notification bell. Happy hitting.